Hello, and welcome to worship today. It's Sunday, January the 3rd of 2021. Happy New Year. A reminder that the words for today's hymns are found in the printed sermon document immediately below the link to the worship video on the St. Columba website. We begin with our call to worship. Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. Lift up your eyes and look around. See and be radiant. Let your hearts rejoice, for the Lord will be our everlasting light and our glory. And so we bring God our worship in humble expectation. Let us worship God in singing our first hymn, As with Gladness Men of Old. Let us pray. God of power and might, grace and love, heaven and earth are full of your glory. You chose to become one of us in Jesus Christ, sharing our joys and sorrows, revealing your greatness in the little child in the manger. And so we praise you for your love, which is great enough to embrace the universe, yet close enough to enter our hearts. During our worship, surprise us with your grace, that we, with the rest of the church and the whole of creation, may praise and adore you, O God, our Creator and Redeemer. Hear us as we confess our sins. God of mercy and loving kindness, you sent Christ among us to be the light of the world and to reveal your love to all people. We confess that our sins hide the brightness of your light that should shine through us. We waste our gifts. We ignore cries for justice. We harm the earth, and we do not strive for peace in the world or with each other. In your mercy, cleanse us and make us new. For we humbly ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, be assured of God's love and forgiveness that shine for us in Christ Jesus. As a new year unfolds, make a new beginning with God and with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you all. Thanks be to God. Our hymn is What Star Is This?
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of this season of light, we long to hear your word and wisdom in fresh and transforming ways. Open our ears to your voice calling to us. Open our eyes to the dawning of a new day. Open our hearts to a new way of living, following Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first scripture reading is from Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 through 6. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah, and all those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. And from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, the visit of the Magi to the child Jesus. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Several years ago, my congregation, St. Columba here in Belleville, generously gave me the perpetual gift of the first Sunday in January as a day off after the busyness of the Advent and Christmas season. I have been so grateful for that Sunday because it means I can rest my mind from sermon writing for a week, and it also means I can spend a whole weekend relaxing with my husband, and I've always truly appreciated it. This year, however, things are somewhat different. With the sanctuary being closed until our region returns to the green protect level, we are continuing to provide online worship services, which means recording a few days ahead of time. Now, in practical terms, that means I have every Sunday off as we worship at home. So I've enjoyed putting today's service together for this Epiphany Sunday because it's the first time in a number of years that I've preached on the story of the Magi visiting wee Jesus and his mother. Last month, on December 21st, the winter solstice included a rather special event. There was a coming together of Jupiter and Saturn that hasn't happened in hundreds of years. The proximity of the two planets gave the effect of a remarkable star, and many were referring to it as the Christmas star. Unfortunately, due to cloud cover, we couldn't see this extraordinary event in our area, but pictures have been released, so we have an idea. What an amazing thing for us as we journeyed through Christmas week, especially this year when Christmas was far more difficult for everyone. It's as if God knew we needed to be reassured that he had been close to us throughout the past year of turmoil and crisis. And even though we could not be personally close with so many of the people we love as we welcomed the Christ child, God remained with us. Scientists said the timing was purely coincidence, but was it? Can God not make this kind of thing happen? God knew we needed some reassurance this year, so let's not dismiss the occurrence as merely coincidence. My friend and colleague, the Reverend David Burkers, wrote this about the celestial event. The wise men we read about in Matthew's gospel followed a star that led them to Jesus, where they were able to give him the gifts they had brought and also to worship him. They were overjoyed when they saw the star, and I can't help but think that God has allowed us to be able to see an amazing event like this Christmas star at a time when we really need to see it. If this had been what we think of as a normal year, we would have been okay with this happening. But I think it is more significant for a world that needs something to remind them that the birth of Jesus, our Savior, is still important and a source of joy. Thank you, God, for such a special gift. As we read the text of the Magi following the star that will lead them to Jesus, we see all kinds of things within the story. There is curiosity, fear, determination, humility, reverence, and warning. The stargazers see this unusual star in the sky and begin to follow it in their quest to discover its meaning. They take precious gifts with them, for there is something special at the end of their journey, a king, the king of the Jews. This royalty must be appropriately recognized. Little did they know what king they would worship as they set out on their starlit journey. Little did they know their journey would take a different path from what they already knew and had planned. Following the star would set them on a new path. The Magi had a plan: follow the star, visit Herod, arrive at their destination, return to Herod, and head home having had a remarkable experience, that much more knowledgeable, that much wiser for their efforts. The best laid plans. Craig Satterley, scholar of preaching and liturgy and a prolific author, has reflected on the experience of the Magi and our experience of their journey with some rather interesting insights. He writes, "God is so determined to proclaim the good news of great joy for all the people that God reaches beyond fields in the region around Bethlehem to the east. God reaches beyond shepherds at the bottom of the barrel to wise ones at the top. God reaches beyond people scared witless by God's glory To those who observe the glorious star at its rising and methodically, persistently, and sincerely follow it to a king. All along the way, God directs them, first by a star, then via a verse from Micah, and finally, in their dreams. So these elite of society do what they do. They follow a star. But as Satterley asserts, these are not the normal people one would have expected to be a part of the Christmas story. They were likely practitioners and even leaders within another religious belief system, one that focused on the highly regarded science of astrology. Satterley continues, so these wise ones from the East were scientists and practiced other religions, and God used their faith and knowledge to bring them to the Christ. More ironic, God used scientists who practiced other religions to let Herod and the chief priests and scribes of the people in on the news that their Messiah had been born. The point is, God reaches far beyond where the limitations of our human thinking take us, to embrace all people and to spread the gospel message to all people. Where we are terribly limited, there is no limit to God's embrace. There is no limit to God's forgiveness. There is no limit to God's grace. No conditions placed on God's love, no boundary to the length and breadth of God's reach. My physical reach is pretty limited. I always have to ask my son to get things down or put things up on those high shelves. His reach is considerably further than mine, but there is a maximum still as to how far his fingertips can go. The reach of my understanding is limited. I have to ask questions, consult scholars, turn to manuals, request help for things I don't know about. I have to trust others to know what they are doing because they are strong in areas in which I am not. And the people to whom I turn also have to turn to others that are strong in areas in which they are not, and so on. Everyone has limits, except God. God's reach, God's understanding, God's knowledge, God's power is unlimited. It has no boundaries. God's ability to embrace even those who seem furthest away from him is unlimited. God's ability to embrace people is often through those who seem the least likely to be successful. Turning back to Satterley's work for a moment, this writer is crystal clear about the unlimitedness and our lack of understanding of God's ways. As he reflects on the Christmas and Epiphany stories and how our loving Creator reached and reached and reached out to those needing to be embraced. God seems to do whatever it takes to reach out to and embrace all people. God announces the birth of the Messiah to shepherds through angels on Christmas, to magi via a star on Epiphany, and to the political and religious authorities of God's own people through visitors from the East. From a manger where a child lies wrapped in bands of cloth, God's reach, God's embrace in Christ Jesus gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Jesus eats with outcasts and sinners. Jesus touches people who are sick and people who live with disabilities. Jesus even calls the dead back to life. Ultimately, Jesus draws all people to himself as he is lifted up on the cross. In Christ Jesus, no one is beyond God's embrace. In Christ Jesus, no one is beyond God's embrace. in Christ Jesus. Satterley continues, God's radical grace is wondrously frightening. I experience a bit of a shudder as I think of the implications of portraying the Magi as scientists who practiced another religion, because to do so pushes me to expand my understanding of both the ways God reaches out to people to announce good news in and through Christ, and what it means for individuals to have faith and for gatherings of the faithful to be the church. See, the reality is the Magi did not come to faith in Christ through the traditional rituals of a faith community. They came by quite a different way. They followed when God beckoned, irresistibly drawn to this new thing they were seeing in the sky. God spoke to them quite outside of sermons and liturgies and practiced expressions of belief. Now, this isn't to say the church is not a means by which God embraces people. Quite the opposite. God expands the family of the faith community through whatever means are going to set people on a different path, the path of faith in Christ Jesus. The gathered people grows as God works to change people's direction in unexpected and unlimited ways. God did not come into the world as it had been expected. God did not live in the world as it had been expected. God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but to embrace it. God did not make the Messiah victorious in the way it had been expected. Instead, God did all these things in the way it had to be, the way it would be successful, in God's way and in God's time. Unexpected? Yes. Ineffective? Absolutely not. God's way is always the most effective way, but we have to remember God's way is often something we don't see coming. It is surprising, amazing, and it can be wonderfully mysterious. God speaks in and through the community of faith. God speaks in and through his servants. God also speaks in and through some unexpected people. He spoke through an angel, a baby, shepherds, magi, dreams. And God embraced people that seemed furthest from him by drawing them closer to him, by following yonder star, their direction was changed. By worshiping Jesus, their direction was changed. By listening to God speak, their direction was changed. God began to resolve the conflict between what we expect and what God does by the birth of an infant Messiah. That infant grew to preach and teach a new way of listening to God, a new way of understanding, a new way of following. And that infant grew from being that teacher to being the Savior. God resolved the final conflict when Jesus was lifted on the cross and raised from the dead. That resolution laid a new direction before his people and set us, on a more gracious, more merciful path that brings us closer and closer to our Lord. God's embrace has no limit. Maybe it should come with a warning label. Warning, following yonder star may change your direction. Embrace it as you are embraced by the limitless love and faithfulness of God through Christ Jesus. Amen. Our hymn is We Three Kings. God of majesty and mystery, what a gift we have received from you in the birth of Jesus. In sincere and deep gratitude and in the example of the Magi, we offer our gifts to you, grateful that you are with us in good times and in hard times. We do not know what the year ahead will hold, but your love shines like a star to guide us. Bless our gifts, that they may keep the light of Christ shining through the church to guide and embrace the world you love. God of all time and space. As we gather in prayer, we recognize that our lives are but small details in the vast expanse of your universe. So we thank you for attending to the details of our lives. We thank you for the year just passed, for walking through the hard days and uncertainties with us, and for the gifts of encouragement and friendship that cheered us. We give thanks for accomplishments in ministry and mission, for generosity offered to those in need, and for new possibilities explored in online worship, education, and outreach. As your Spirit guides us into the future, our hearts kneel before you, O God. Receive our humble prayers. The year just ending has held so many sorrows and challenges for so many. We remember dear ones who have died and pray for those who look ahead in loneliness or sadness. We pray for those who have faced challenges in health, in their families, or at work. Support each one who needs you close by. Our hearts kneel before you, O God. Receive our humble prayers. God of light and love, as we face the year ahead, we are aware that much around us is still uncertain. We seek your strength and guidance in each challenge we will face. Draw near to each one who must confront illness, loss, or changing circumstances. Guide those for whom new opportunities appear and choices must be made. Our hearts kneel before you, O God. Receive our humble prayers. God of community and commitment, we pray for wisdom and courage in the year ahead. Strengthen us as a congregation, as your church, to be a committed witness to your love. Help us reach out to our community in creative ways and make us effective citizens in these challenging times. Guide leaders in our nation and in nations around the world so that justice and peace may prevail, resources to meet health and hunger needs are shared, and understanding and respect will grow among divided peoples. Receive our humble prayers and encourage us onward. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And now, may grace, mercy, and peace from God's unlimited reach and unconditional love be with you this day, in the year to come, and in all the days that follow. Amen. Our closing chorus is Walk with the Lord.